Insulin, that's the big one, right? Here's the medication that we have to use for type 1 diabetics. It's what tells the body to uptake glucose, amino acids, nucleotides, and potassium. Would you do me a favor and just circle potassium there? Just as a side note, I want you to keep in mind that we can use insulin for potassium that's too high. So sometimes this is used as a treatment for people who have hyperkalemia. We give them insulin. Now, clearly we're going to have to help keep their blood sugar up too, but we can use insulin for non-diabetic patients to treat hyperkalemia. Now, we'll also promote the synthesis of these organic molecules that you know, glycogen and proteins and triglycerides. So insulin is a pretty complex impact on the whole body. Have you ever wondered where they come from? Well, they're sources of insulin. Recombinant DNA, that's all the insulins that are now manufactured in the United States. So I want to talk about human insulin versus human insulin analogs. Okay, so underline human insulin and then analogs, because I want to kind of point this out so you can understand and remember the drug names easier. So both of these categories have the same actions, but different time courses. Okay, so same actions, but different time courses. That's important that you remember that between human insulin and human insulin analogs. Now, old school, we used to have beef and pork pancreas. That was used to be available, but it's no longer available. I just wanted to tell you about it so if someone asks you, you don't look at them like, what? Yeah, no, it used to happen, but we don't offer that in the United States anymore. We stopped using the beef and the date there, and we stopped using the pork in 2006. So it's been a very long time since we used this, but your patients may have some really old information. Let's talk about where the insulin that we do use and where it comes from. Now, here's the difference between human insulin and insulin analog. Human insulin is manufactured when they take a DNA code for making human insulin and they put it into a bacteria or yeast cells. Then they purify it and it's sold as human insulin. So we're not taking it from donors. It's not like blood where you can have a blood donor and then you give it. We're taking the DNA code, we're putting it inside bacteria or yeast. Then what's produced is purified and sold as human insulin. Now, insulin analog is an altered form of insulin. It's different from natural insulin, but it's still usable by the human body. See if you recognize some of these names. Huma, log, Nova, log, or Apidra. Oh, that one's not as fun, but that's why these drugs have their names of Humalog and Novalog. That will help you remember it. So it's not exactly the same as human insulin, but it's able to be used by the body and do the similar things of insulin. That's the difference between human insulin and insulin analog, right? So neither one is coming from a human donor. They're made in different ways, but they both have their uses with diabetic patients. Now, here's how I recommend you really zeroing in on this slide and learning these categories for insulin. You see across the top, we have short duration rapid acting. Now, what that means is doesn't last very long, short duration, and it kicks in really quick. So rapid acting means, woo, they'll feel the effect pretty quickly, but it's not gonna last a long time. Now, how many drug names do we have there? Good, you can still count at this point, I'm impressed. So you've got three, insulin lispro, insulin aspart, and insulin glucosylate. You've got those three there. This slide is worth making copies because this is critically important that you understand that. I'm not as interested in you memorizing minutes of peak onset and duration. Maybe you had that in your faculty, but here, this is great information in a way that you can remember it for a long time. You can remember that these three insulins don't last very long, but they kick in really quickly. You can remember that regular insulin doesn't last very long, but it's slower acting than, right, the category before it. The third category, intermediate duration. So that's like NPH or Humulin N or insulin Detemir. So I've got short duration rapid acting, short duration slower acting, intermediate duration, and long duration. So really, it's only three categories: short duration, intermediate duration, long duration. Start there, make sure you have those. Then you can break down short duration to rapid acting and slower acting. Make sure that's solid. Then review the intermediate duration category and the long duration category. Okay, this is the way I recommend you putting the information in your brain about insulins. You honestly can't remember onset, peak, and duration for 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. It's not going to stick with you. So do the work of memorizing this information as chunked information, and it'll stick with you much, much longer. So now your chance. I know, but do it without looking at your notes. Ready? Here's your question. I titled this one, Keeping Up Appearances. See, it used to be that all clear insulins were short acting because regular was the only clear one. But now there are four clear short acting ones. We've got them listed there for you. And two more are clear, but they're prolonged acting. So that's pretty important that you know that, especially when we talk about the order of insulin being drawn up. Now, which ones can go IV? What do you think? All right, there's the group that can be given IV and the group that cannot be given IV. So make sure you know that when you're reviewing the IV medications for diabetes. Now, the concentrations of insulin in the U.S., that's the key, usually is 100 units per mil or U100. Now, it does exist 500 units per mil, but only Humulin R. This would be used for very, very severe diabetics. It's not normally kept on any unit because you obviously can see the risk to patients. If we had 500 units and 100 units per mil on the same unit, it'd be a strong risk for somebody to get five times the dose that was ordered. So we do use it in very special occasions, but it's labeled separately, kept separately. We're really careful with it so we don't overdose our other patients. You will predominantly see the 100 units per mil in practice. Now, mixing insulins, we talked about that, why it's important that you remember which one is clear. We've got a single shot advantage where we mix them because we can just give it all in one shot, but only NPH is appropriate for mixing with short-acting insulins, regular, lispro, aspart, and glucosamine. So you draw the short-acting up first. Good. The short acting up first. Excellent slide reading there by you. Now, the mixtures are stable for usually about 28 days, but keep that in mind. You always draw the short acting one up first. Now, the temperature of insulins, if the vial hasn't been opened, it's usually stored under refrigeration as needed. But once the vial's been opened, we can use it for up to 1 month without significant impact. So keep that in mind. How long is insulin good for? After it's opened, up to 1 month. Otherwise, watch the expiration date that's stamped right on the label. Now, it's better if you inject the room temperature insulin, not the super cold insulin. It's less pain for the patient, and it'll cause less lipidodystrophy. So what does that mean? Lipidos, referring to fat, and dystrophy, like, where you have that side effect of injected insulin. Sometimes diabetics have that. So by teaching them to give themselves room temperature insulin, there's less risk for pain and the longer-term effect of lipidodystrophy. Now, when you're doing subcutaneous injection, those are our options there that we have available for it. And subcutaneous infusion would involve a portable insulin pump or an implantable insulin pump. Even patients that are compliant, when they start using a pump, they have much better glucose control. Problem is, they're a little pricey. They can be kind of expensive, but they're fantastic for maintaining a lower blood sugar control. So we're talking about sub-Q administration. These are the options. The subcutaneous injections on the left are the single time we give it, but the subcutaneous options on the right involve pumps and can have continuous administration.